For years, the images taken with the Hubble Space Telescope have inspired millions of people. So many colors, such detailed structures. Many of these images combine data using special filters of hydrogen, oxygen, and sulfur. Today's technology allows amateur astronomers to also get colorful images of nebula using these special filters. Even I got very nice color images while I was working on my PhD thesis in 2005 and 2006, and I hope that very soon I will be getting some few more images of these, but using my very own amateur telescope.
But how do we get these colors? It is a trick? Is it Photoshop? Or do nebula actually have these colors in real life? Well, for understanding this, we first need to know a little bit of atomic physics.
Here it is, a very schematic representation of an hydrogen atom. As all atoms, it has a nucleus and electrons orbiting around it. Hydrogen is the simplest element in nature. Its nucleus is usually just a proton. An atom has not net electric charge, as the proton is plus one and the electron minus one. But energetic radiation can make the hydrogen atom to lose its electron. Now it is an hydrogen ion, just the proton, with electric charge plus one. We say that the hydrogen atom has been ionized. Eventually, the ion will absorb an electron. That is the opposite phenomenon to ionization. We call it recombination. The electron will emit sunlight, a photon, when recombines with the hydrogen atom.
And now we can explain how nebula shine. The ultraviolet radiation of a massive star, or a white dwarf in the case of a planetary nebula, is ionizing the hydrogen gas.
When the hydrogen ion recombines, it emits a photon, making the nebula shine in very peculiar color, H alpha here. However, there are many energy levels in an hydrogen atom. The electron will jump from one to another till it reaches the level with the lowest energy, the ground state. Every photon that the electron emits has unique characteristics. Only some transitions between the energy levels are allowed. Each one will create a photon with a unique frequency or wavelength.
And that is why hydrogen, the simplest element in nature, show plenty of emission lines in its spectrum.
Physicists define the spectrum as the full range of frequencies of the electromagnetic radiation, the light. The optical spectrum is just the rainbow, and it is a fundamental key for understanding nature. This is the emission line spectrum of the hydrogen atom in visible light. In this representation, the wavelength increases from left to right. Left has the blue colors with short wavelengths, high frequencies and energies, and right has the red colors with long wavelengths and low frequencies and energies. We write the atomic hydrogen as H1, being 1 a Roman number. The main emission lines of H1 are H alpha at 6563 angstroms, H beta at 4861 angstroms, H gamma at 4341 angstroms, and H delta at 4101 angstroms. There are many more lines, of course. Let's have a look to how these emission lines are created. Even for the hydrogen atom, there are many different energy levels. Do you remember studying the principal quantum number in school? These are the numbers shown here, with 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. The ground level, the state with the lowest energy, is in level 1. All levels but the ground level has several sublevels, but I will not enter into more details here. An electron that jumps from level 3 to level 2 will emit a photon at 6563 angstroms, an H alpha photon. Similarly, an electron jumping from level 4 to level 2 will emit an H beta photon. An electron jumping from level 5 to level 2 will emit an H gamma photon. All electronic jumps ending in level 2 are named Balmer photons.
So yes, if it is not clear after all of this, for studying astrophysics, we also need plenty of atomic, nuclear, and quantum physics.
Eventually, the electron will reach the ground state jumping to the level 1, If a transition happens from level 2, the electron will emit a Lehmann alpha photon in the ultraviolet at 1216 angstroms.
However, although nebulas are mainly made of hydrogen, they also have other elements. Helium, oxygen, carbon, nitrogen, sulfur, neon, iron. Can we also observe emission lines coming from these elements?
Of course. Let's have a look to the oxygen atom. After hydrogen and helium, oxygen is the third most abundant element of the universe. And indeed, it is very important in astronomy. An oxygen atom has 8 electrons orbiting a nucleus with 8 protons and 8 neutrons. If one of the electrons absorbs an energetic photon, the oxygen atom will be ionized. Now we have an oxygen ion with electric charge plus 1. Sometimes even a second electron can be removed. The oxygen atom has been doubly ionized. Its electric charge is plus 2. On Earth, oxygen ions do not last long. They quickly recombine the missing electrons to form electrically neutral atoms. So when we analyze the spectrum of the oxygen atom in laboratories, this is what we see, many emission lines. Want to count for yourself? Go to this webpage and introduce the values for oxygen atom in the optical range, between 35 and 3500 angstroms. We get 1192 lines. But these are not the emission lines we observe in nebula.
What is the problem? Well, basically because the physical conditions on nebula are very different to the physical conditions that we have here on Earth. The densities in nebula are very, very low. Imagine that typically we have 10, 100, 1000 particles per centimeter cube in nebula. Here on Earth, the densities are at least 10 orders of magnitude larger than that.
This means that the oxygen ions in nebula are going to live for some time, and these ions also have plenty of electron transitions. A very important ion is the doubly ionized oxygen. This spectrum is only observed in nebula because of their very low densities. These features were a mystery for many years, particularly the very bright emission at 5007 angstroms. In 1864, two pioneers of the astronomical spectroscopy, William and Margaret Higgins, detected the bright emission lines of the doubly ionized oxygen in their observation of the Cat's Eye Nebula. In June 1898, Margaret Higgins published a paper in the 8th edition of the Astrophysical Journal, proposing that these lines were the features of an element they called nebulium. It is sad to see that Margaret Higgins' paper has only received 5 citations, 4 of them a century after its publication. In 1927, the American physicist Ira Sprague Bowen showed that the lines are indeed emitted by the doubly ionized oxygen.
In astronomy, any element that is not hydrogen or helium, it is a metal. For an astronomer, oxygen, carbon, nitrogen, sulfur, iron, gold, they are all metals. Under very low densities, metallic ions can survive for a long time. And that is what happens in nebula. And they emit light because they collide with the free electrons in the gas.
The collisions between the free electrons of the gas and metallic ions can move the electrons of the ions to higher levels. Soon, the electrons of metallic ions go back to the ground state, emitting photons. These photons create emission lines that are called collisionally excited lines. We can't observe these lines on Earth because they are only created under the extreme low densities of nebula. The energy level configuration of the oxygen plus plus ion is much more complex than that we saw for the hydrogen atom. But using atomic physics, we can establish some key levels that combine several quantum numbers. Again, I'm not going into details here, but there are 5 main energy levels in the oxygen plus plus ion. An electron jumping from the top level to the second one will emit an ultraviolet photon. The electronic transition producing the 4363 angstrom emission is quite important for our work, as it is key to estimate the electron temperature of the gas. But that is a story for another day. The two main emission lines of the oxygen plus plus ion are 4959 angstroms and 5007 angstroms. By atomic physics, they are in a perfect relation 1-3. These are the two bright lines that were identified as nebulium by Margaret and William Higgins. Finally, these two transitions in the infrared are also important. All of these are called forbidden transitions. they only appear at very low densities and can be only explained when we consider not the usual electric dipole approximation to quantum mechanics, but a higher level of approximation such as magnetic dipole or electric quadrupole. When physicists established the existence of the forbidden lines, they had to find a way of naming them. These lines cannot be written as oxygen 2, because they are not coming from the recombination of an oxygen plus plus ion. Similarly, they cannot be written as oxygen 3, as they are coming from recombining oxygen plus 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 ions. So physicists decided to name the forbidden lines with square brackets. Let's see that again. An oxygen 3 transition with brackets is a collisionally excited line of an oxygen plus plus ion. An oxygen 3 transition without the brackets is a recombination line in an oxygen plus plus ion. In the first case, the ion was always at oxygen plus plus, but in the second case, it was an oxygen plus 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 ion before. Oxygen 3 lines with bracket are forbidden lines, only observable in very low densities. Oxygen 3 without brackets are permitted lines and can be observed in normal densities. They are not the same thing. The emission lines of metallic elements in nebula are collisionally excited lines, forbidden transitions. They must be written with brackets, as the very famous oxygen 3 and sulfur 2 emission lines that we observe in nebula and galaxies. However, the emission lines of hydrogen and helium in nebula are recombination lines, that is, permitted transitions. They are written as usual, without the brackets.
And that is actually one of the main points I wanted to get with this video. If you are not including the square brackets when you are talking about the ion transition of oxygen, nitrogen or sulfur in nebula, then you are referring to something different. And that is not right.
With this, what is the typical optical spectrum of a nebula? Well, first we have the hydrogen recombination lines from the Balmer series, H-alpha, H-beta, H-gamma, H-delta. After H-alpha, the brightest emission line in the optical spectrum of a nebula is the oxygen 3 emission, with bracket, at 5007 angstroms. Sometimes, this emission line is even brighter than H-alpha. Oxygen 3-4959 is typically observed very close to H-beta. Another very bright feature is the oxygen 2 doublet, with brackets, that is almost in the ultraviolet, at 3727 angstroms. The emission line of oxygen 1 with brackets, that is neutral oxygen that has been excited by collisions, it is at 6300 angstroms. Some few other important emission lines are those coming from the collisionally excited nitrogen plus ions, very close to H-alpha, and the sulfur 2 doublet emission, with brackets, at 6716 and 6731 angstroms. Finally, some recombination lines of helium can be also observed. Remember, all emission lines from metallic elements are coming from forbidden transitions and must be written with brackets, but hydrogen and helium lines are pure recombination lines.
Great! Now that we understand what these emission lines are, how do we get the colors of the nebula?
First, we have to remember that professional astronomical observations are always conducted using monochrome cameras. We observe the cosmos in black and white because we want to measure well the amount of light that we receive. However, we always use filters for isolating part of the light. Typically, these filters have been very broad. B, V, R. Each filter is codified with a color. B in blue, V in green, and R in red. And we achieve a color image that approximates to what our eyes will be able to see. For decades, even before the Hubble Space Telescope was launched, professional astronomers have used narrow filters for isolating bright emission lines, like H-alpha or oxygen 3. Using a third narrow filter, for example one isolating the sulfur 2 emission, we can get a nice false color image showing the emission lines of the nebula. Considering their wavelength, oxygen 3 is codified in blue, H-alpha in green, and sulfur 2 in red. This color composition is now known as the Hubble palette, because it has been fully exploited with the data obtained with the Hubble Space Telescope. Note, however, that in addition to create beautiful color images, This color composition also provides plenty of useful astrophysical information. The green color mapping the H-alpha emission shows the distribution of the ionized gas in the nebula, the ionized hydrogen. Doubly ionized oxygen, in blue, shows regions in the nebula that are quite excited, as oxygen plus plus ions are there. Not all nebula have this area. Single ionized sulfur, in red, are usually related to a bit colder regions in the nebula, and they are also very good marking changes of density, for example, walls or filaments.
In summary, yes, these images are real. And it is awesome that narrowband filters that isolated the light coming from the hydrogen alpha emission or the oxygen 3 forbidden transition or the sulfur 2 forbidden transition are now so common among amateur astronomers.
Amateur astronomers are really obtaining outstanding images of the cosmos using these narrowband filters. Many are not aware that they could start doing real astrophysical observations with them. One step forward is understanding the physics behind the colors, and the reason why oxygen 3, without brackets, is not the same thing that the oxygen 3, with brackets. So please remember, the emission lines of metallic elements we observe in nebula and galaxies are forbidden lines. They only appear in extreme low-density gases because of the collision of ions with the free electrons in the gas. For distinguishing these lines from the standard recombination lines, we name them with brackets. Please, don't forget to use them to provide the real scientific information you are achieving with your amazing narrowband filter images of nebula.